Hello everyone, my name is Ashish. Welcome to my channel where I talk about cybersecurity. Today's topic is access keys, AWS access keys. Before we get into it, probably click the subscribe button over here somewhere or hit the bell icon so you get notified whenever there's a new video. Now, what are AWS access keys? I do understand when I'm talking about AWS access keys, some of you may be aware of what AWS access keys are, and you just want to get to the AWS best practices for access keys. So feel free to skip to half of the video where you would see and hear from the AWS best practice for access keys. For those who are here and are not sure, would love some more information about access keys, let's get into it. So in this video, we will talk about AWS access keys. What are they? Why would you need access keys? And where can you find them? And also towards the end, we'll talk about what's a good pattern, what's a best practice, what's an anti-pattern, and who should use it. It should be a startup or it should be enterprise. Who should be using access keys? So let's get into it. AWS access keys are a pair of credentials which allow you access to AWS endpoints over an encrypted channel. Essentially, access keys are a pair of two credentials, kind of similar to your username and password, which you require to authenticate and talk to AWS endpoints so that you can make AWS do, execute commands on AWS resources that are there in that account. Now, AWS access keys consist of AWS access key ID and secret access key. So these credentials are to be used together. You can generate them in an AWS account, and you would require these when you're using the AWS CLI to talk to AWS resources or when you're talking to the AWS API. Now, since we know what AWS access keys are, it's worthwhile calling out that these access key ID and secret access key should be treated the same way you would treat your username and password, as these would allow anyone with this information to be able to execute commands on your AWS accounts. What that means is no sticky notes with access keys, hopefully. They're too long, but just in case you think it's a good idea, make sure you don't share them with people you don't trust. Use it wisely and store it in a safe way. I would go into our best practices, so you'll probably hear me say a few more things which you can do around taking care of your AWS keys. But before we do that, let's go into why do we even need AWS access keys. I personally believe AWS access key is a really good feature in AWS. And the reason for this being, a lot of functions on your on-prem systems are not API driven, which means they cannot be automated. You can't write a script and execute a lot of commands in a matter of minutes over hundreds of machines. That stuff, that it takes ages. And what that also means is it's harder for you to automate things in on-prem environments. However, because AWS is API enabled first, everything that you click on AWS, you can use to automate in any command form. Now, the reality behind this is this makes a security person, as well as a DevSecOps engineer, a DevOps engineer, even a developer who has access to infrastructure on AWS, can use these API keys or access keys to talk to the AWS API and automate a lot of stuff, which means, actually worthwhile calling out, AWS access keys can be used to execute commands which are very, very benign, say something similar to finding out who you are, which I think is get caller identification or get caller identity. The other extreme where it gets really dangerous is when you can open S3 bucket to public. And that's probably the other extreme where you don't want it to be public and it becomes public accidentally. You don't want to be in that state, right? So that's kind of where the use case lies. But for me personally, as a security person and as someone who's out there trying to educate about automating everything, automating security, make security say yes instead of no, I'm a huge believer in it. And I believe the API enable architecture of AWS or cloud in general is helping us proceed in a direction where security is able to do this. Now, what this means, as a security guy, you can patch all your systems in one single command or write one script with all your commands. You can find out all the AWS services that are currently in your AWS account by writing a script. You can find out if you have any machines in AWS that are affected by a recent vulnerability that came out. So when Heartbleed came out, a lot of people were not aware what assets in their environment would be affected. So this could be one of those features which you can use to find out if you're affected by a vulnerability in one script in all your AWS accounts, right? That makes this amazing. Now, this is probably a question of maturity as well. A lot of people can do this in a matter of day. And the other extreme to this is when you go so mature that you can even start raising alarms for activity you find in your AWS account, which you consider is malicious. For example, a access key being recreated for a user, a second access key being recreated for a user. That could be a behavior that you may not like. Or what about access keys being created for root users? That's something you want to be aware of, right? Now, where do I find access keys? You can find the access keys in two places or two ways of finding out. If you already have an access key or do you want one, the easiest one to go is on the AWS Management Console. You head to IAM. I'm going to open IAM over here. Once you quickly open IAM, you realize that it will show you a list of users. And I'm just going to go for the one which is Cyclops. I'm going to open it up. And now we're in security credentials. That's the tab that you want to use to find out if you have access keys. Once you go in, at the moment, I don't have any. I'm just going to create one. You know what? I'm going to create two. So, and as you can see, it shows the status of the access key. It's active or inactive. If you make them inactive, you can basically, you can't use them. If you keep them active, you can use both of them. Now, this is clearly not the best practice to have multiple access keys, but anyway, this is just for experiment's sake. How does access key work? The access keys are used to authenticate to AWS endpoints. Essentially, if you have an IAM user with access keys, you can use that to talk to and authenticate to AWS endpoints. Once you authenticate to the AWS endpoint, from that point onwards, there's a secret which is shared between AWS and your machine, or I guess your terminal, or PowerShell if you're a Windows person. And from that point onwards, all the following subsequent commands are signed with the request, which is that secret that is shared between you and Amazon. This also helps in reduce replay attack. What that means is if I get access to someone else's access key and I'm trying to do the same command at, okay, maybe too complex for this particular video. Let's get back into this one when we talk about hacking into AWS account much later. All right. So now we've spoken about what are AWS access keys, what are they used for, where you can find them, and how do they work. Now the obvious question is, are there limitations, or as a security person, or as a security enthusiast, if you are interested in using access keys the right way, there would be certain things you need to be aware of to know as limitations or features within AWS access keys. It's worthwhile noting that IAM users can only have a maximum of two AWS access keys, and each access key has an active inactive status against it, which is what I kind of showed you earlier with my user. And the AWS access users, or the AWS access key would have the same permission as the user that the access keys were created for. So if I have a user with admin privileges and I give them access to, I give them access keys, what that would mean is, whenever he or she uses those access keys, or someone who has those access keys uses them, they would be using it with the same permission as the user it was created for. Now, this scenario may raise a few alarms for you, which would also mean that, wait, there are so many people doing so many things to my AWS account. How do I keep a track of that, right? Fortunately, AWS has a solution for that as well. You can use AWS CloudTrail, which logs all API activity in an AWS account. So you can see what was done by those access keys by what user. Extra points for AWS for that. So I've spoken a lot about access keys. What are they? Where you can find them? Why do you need them? What are the limitations? So now this is the crux of the video about AWS best practices, security best practices for access keys. And welcome to the guys who basically skipped over to the half of from the beginning. So hey guys, I'm glad you're here. So the AWS access key, I'll talk about security best practices in terms of patterns and anti-patterns. Let's start with the patterns first. When you do generate access keys, you can generate access keys for any IAM user. That's not a bad problem, that's a good pattern. However, do not create it for a root user ever, ever, ever. Do not create it for an AU root user of your AWS account. You can generate AWS access keys for IAM user. You can generate access keys for your federated user. However, do not create access keys for your root user, never, right? That's the first pattern. Second one, wherever possible, use AWS STS, which is AWS Security Token Service. It can be used to provide temporary access to users when you don't really want to give them permanent permissions or permanent keys to a user. So access keys are essentially like a username and password, as I said earlier. What that means is they're kind of like long-term credentials. As long as they're active, anyone can use them, irrespective if it's you or someone who has stolen it from you. Now, since we have that out of the way, because they are so sensitive and I guess need to be used appropriately, I recommend using AWS-generated temporary credentials via AWS STS. Now, although there are scenarios where you're forced to use access keys, if you do end up using access keys, I would highly, highly recommend rotating them, especially if your access keys have admin privileges. If your access keys has admin privileges, I would even recommend having MFA on them, just so that there's another layer to give you that satisfaction. The next obvious one, because we are talking about permissions, is if you have a user with access keys, make sure he has enough permission to only fulfill his job. Nothing more, nothing less. So it's important to keep the permission restricted to the kind of functions they want to perform in the organization. Nothing more, nothing less. You can use federated users as well. If you're a big enough organization, you can have a federated user which can automatically log in into AWS account. You don't have to use IAM users. As part of getting a federated access, you can get you can use a tool to get access to AWS access keys and perform the same functions automatically. So that's not a bad idea either. Now, these are some of the patterns that I recommend. Now, let's get into the anti-patterns. What you should not do. I've already spoken about the one which is really, really, really important, which is do not give access keys to your root user. Another anti-pattern we see a lot, or at least I see a lot, is when you have a third-party service, a SaaS application, a lot of these products would ask you to provide them with IAM user and access keys so that they can log in into your AWS account and perform functions. Now, if it's a SaaS service, and if it's asking you for IAM user, I would say reconsider working with them, because the best practice for any third-party service to talk to AWS account is using a third-party IAM role. What this means is you do not give them access keys, you do not need to give them IAM user. If they haven't worked out on how to use IAM roles, which is that third-party IAM roles, you probably should reconsider working with them, because they clearly haven't figured out cloud yet, or at least the right way to use cloud yet. So, rotating keys, obviously, the more sensitive the account, that's how often you probably want to, probably 3 to 6 months is a good period to rotate access keys. Having multiple access keys, so by default, you can only create 2 access keys. I'd probably, if you are forced in a situation where you have to keep access keys, restrict it to only 1 and make sure it's regularly audited in terms of you validate whether the person still requires IAM access keys. Another anti-pattern is you would see a lot of people hard coding access keys into their code or mobile apps which require access to AWS resources. Now that's a bad pattern. Again, figure out a way to use IAM roles or pre-signed URLs. That's the way to go. Last one is obviously generating access keys which has cross-account access, probably a bad idea as well. But then again, my overall recommendation is if you're a startup, I completely understand you may not have federated users or federated identity providers for federating into AWS. So it's completely understandable you're going for something like IAM users with access keys. Totally understand. But if you do, if you have users with admin privileges, to switch on MFA or provide those access keys rotation, it is possible to rotate these keys automatically in AWS. As I said, everything is API enabled. So definitely rotate them. It's more for you than for anything else, right? And lastly, if you're an enterprise, only use federated users. Do not use IAM users. So that's kind of the end of the video. And if you do want to read more about things I've spoken about, I've left a link in the description for the Medium article that I wrote about the same thing. And feel free to share, subscribe, leave a comment, like. Would love to hear from you guys and what else you guys think about access keys. Are you using access keys? If you are, how are you guys using it? Is there something that I missed? Is there something that you would like to add to the list? I would love to hear from you. Until then, peace out.